We are still on air. Good afternoon and welcome back to the Touchline. My name is Max Olwasike. This afternoon we catch up with Paul Bitoka, renowned volleyball coach, now in acting capacity as the tactician for the national women's team, Malkia Strikers, and he did tremendously well overseas with the Rwandese national team, getting full support of Paul Kagame, the president of the Republic of Rwanda. And I'm going to start with that question. Do you think it's high time we can get support from the president here if our sport has to grow?
Yes, I think it is possible, because the first time we visited State House, when we were going for the flag off to Morocco, I personally greeted him and I told him I'm back from Rwanda, and he was surprised. He didn't know that I was in Rwanda, so I got blessings. And I think yesterday, Piers himself said that he's looking forward to request President to give me the contract as a coach of Malkia Strikers. So that means we are talking of the two presidents who are giving me the blessings.
You had hinted of your exit from the scene of being the tactician of Malkia Strikers, saying that probably in the future he will offer an advisory role. Do you think the intervention of PS Ambassador Kirimi Kaberia might enable you to rescind your earlier decision?
For sure, when I came back from Rwanda, it was about what I was coming to do. I didn't expect to be the coach for the women. I was thinking that I'm coming in to help the Kenyan Volleyball Federation in different capacity. As I told you earlier, that I'm planning to have the National League to be played inside a youth and junior to be introduced in men and women. And unfortunately that they called me, and being called by the government to assist a team, all the time I'm always ready, and I took over the Malkia Strikers and helped them for these 2 months. And when I came back, I told them that it seems now it is like a job, and we have to sit down if I have to do something with you. I wanted to be a consultant or to give them advice and to help them in a different way. But we met 2 days ago with the president of Kenya Volleyball Federation, and also the PS was with us, and they're looking forward. They saw that there is something that have changed from the team and the results is coming in. They felt that I should continue as the coach. So that's why we are still negotiating, and I think we will finish soon.
Fred Obenda, I know you are an ardent lover of volleyball as a sport, and you are keenly following the proceedings of FIVB World Cup in Japan. Kenya managed to pick a win against Cameroon, and but the most important thing, the learning curve from the championship was, you know, the coming out of young talent Sharon Chepchumba starring in the entire championship. Do you think the realization of new talents to replace the aging Jane Washu, Janet Wanja, Masi Moim is more important than the result?
Exactly. You know, we call it change of guard, old guard. You know, when we have the new talent, as we've been discussing with the guru himself, Paul Bitok, is the most important thing, the most positive thing that maybe I know, as he was saying, when he was coming back, he's saying that he has some ideas. He had some ideas that he needs to help them. Maybe now he can tell us, because you need to have a system to be able to get these results and the new talent. Now it's up to him now to explain to us. Maybe he has a vision. What are the strategies, Mr. Paul Bitok, that you are thinking of now getting the new talent into the limelight of the nation?
Yeah, first of all, we have a problem of basics. You always hear that we are problem of reception, problem of blocks, service. This one is coming out of what we are doing every day as a Kenyan Volleyball Federation. I retired in 2004 as a player. We used to play Eldoret, Kisumu, Nakuru, and we are still doing the same. I was talking to the chairman, I told him, we have to change. We have to play indoor. We have problem of reception because we are playing our matches out, out of the arena. We must use indoor
facilities
if possible. And one way, we must introduce the league to be played indoor, so that every day they are training indoor and also playing their matches indoor. And the challenge was the sponsorship. And I've gone ahead and requested a few companies, and they are willing to help us. And very soon we are going to announce the sponsor for next year. The other thing that we are trying to come up now is the youth and junior program. As you are talking about the older players being there for a very long time, it's the right time now to have the youth and junior participating in the competition. There was the World Championship in Egypt last month. Cameroon and Egypt were representing Africa. We are the African champion, and we are not representing Africa in the world level when it comes to the youth and junior. So there's something wrong. Now our men's team, they are nowhere, because we have no program for the youth and junior. And I believe that if we start such programs, it will bring back our men's team, and also give us more chances for the women, adapting the right basics when it comes to the senior level. We reach there, we have good scores with the big teams, we reach 22, but because we have not good in reception, or we didn't practice when we were young, so the other team will take advantage and they will finish the match. So all the time we are about to win, but we are not winning because there's something lacking.
Okay. And as Zia said, that now it's do you think our facilities in the Kenyan environment have been a major undoing to us as compared to our competitors outside there?
Because you've mentioned about the indoor facilities.
Exactly.
Is it high time now Kenyan teams can start getting exposed to such well-equipped facilities, so that when they are participating in overseas championships, it's not a strange thing they are encountering?
You see, we have these facilities. It's only the format that we are using which is a problem. If we had introduced indoor arenas or indoor league, we could have already identified many indoor stadium here. I have visited several when I was giving out the proposal. I went to Moi Air Base. There is a very beautiful gymnasium there. Parklis Bank in Sports Club there, they have one. We have Nyayo Stadium. It is only the scoreboard which is hanging in the middle of the court, which should be removed and put aside, and then we can continue using the Nyayo Stadium. We have Kasarani. So that means we are not lacking facilities. It's only the format that we need to change, not having our competition being played in different region. And it is possible also to have in our counties. When I introduced the same system in Rwanda, we had only one gymnasium in Amahoro Stadium. But as we are talking now, there are four which have been built, because the teams which are participating from the district level, they have already built their own. And out of this, President His Excellency Paul Kagame decided now to build the bigger one, which he launched last month, and it was full to capacity of 10,000. He was regretting that he should have built of maybe 20 to accommodate the people who are now enjoying the facilities of indoor. So this indoor can generate also money, because people will be paying to come in. So that means when you are a host team, you will still generate some money for your team. So it is a right time for us to change, and also to change the league
format.
Format we'll have to change, but the time of playing for the national team and also club level is different. FIVB have put it clear. In October to May is for club level, and from May to September or October is a national team assignment. So we have to differentiate the two, and to give chance also the club players who have been paid by club, but they are all the time with the national team and they are not playing for their clubs.
You've spent better part of your career in terms of coaching in Rwanda, and I know besides facilities and even goodwill, commitment, dedication from the government through the president himself, Paul Kagame, what else can Kenya learn from their fellow East African compatriots in terms of growing the game back home?
In Rwanda, Ministry of Sports, they are the sponsor of the national team. You find here most of the federations they depend on other sponsors to come in to help them. Because Ministry of Sports, maybe they will give a small amount as part of their sponsor to the national team. But I'm very happy. Before going to Morocco, PS came to the camp and he was talking of the new system that he was trying to introduce, the hotels for the national team, allowances of the players to be put in the account of individual, not someone carrying the money for the team. And this is what has been in Rwanda for the last 10 years there. When I was in Rwanda, when it comes to national team, a national coach, because most of the coaches in Rwanda are foreigners, and I was the only African coach who was coaching there, and you just give out your program 21 days before the competition. There is an hotel for the national team. You just go and check in. There is facilities for the court. Not like here, you have to go and look for money to pay Kasarani to use. When it comes to national team, the arena is free for the national team. So anytime that you want to train, there is a facility for the national team. Not like most of the time we have to call the press to come and help us. We have been locked out of Kasarani, things like that. So these are things which we have to change also in Kenya to allow all national team assignment to be gathered by the Ministry of Sports.
Fred Openda, you know, Coach will agree with us that, you know, all the local tacticians who have served in overseas leagues find it lucrative and they can't come back home. I don't know what informed you are coming back. Is it giving back to the society and serving the community, or is it patriotism that was the driving factor?
I think
because I know Rwanda, it has full privileges than Kenya.
I really made an history in Rwanda. I was the only coach who managed to stay there for more than 2 years, because the contract you signed with Rwanda, you have to achieve. If you don't achieve, you have to get the letter of going back to your country. And I thank God that I sacrificed a lot and I managed to do my best. And I realized that after doing all my effort and good results from youth, junior, beach volleyball, I said there is a foundation for them. I have left legacy. I have to go back home. I need also to give back home something. And that's why I was coming back home here, not as a coach, but to be like advisor, consultant, or being one of the leaders to bring in my experience. I played in Tunisia 4 years. I was in Croatia for 4 years. I have been in Rwanda. I have good experience to give back to the community. I'm already starting one with my own school in Eldoret, Paul Bitok Academy. I have now the 12 years and below who are training volleyball and also athletics. So I want to lead and using my experience now to give to the nation, not only to myself in Eldoret.
I think I will be one of the parents, because Ravel, the young one who is watching, might be passionate about volleyball, and I will be enrolling him soon. Hopefully you won't be exorbitant to charge me more.
As long as he's tall and qualified to be one of the big players in
so young people start at the tender age.
At tender age, because my coaching career started when I was in Tunis. My coach was a teacher, and when they were in PE time, he could send me some of the kids to come and play with me. I could train them. So I realized that those kids now, they were the ones who are playing the national team of Tunisia. And I say to myself, I would love to give back to the community in Simat village. And that's what I'm starting now.
Okay, Coach, are you, when you were talking, you mentioned about beach volleyball. Where do you place beach volleyball in the Kenyan sport?
There is nothing which is impossible. When I started this in Rwanda, I realized that indoor, the other countries are already very far. But in beach volleyball, they were not yet started in many of the countries. So I started with Rwanda in 2013. It took me only 3 years to become African champion.
Wow.
Rwanda has been ranked the first for the last 7 years in the women. Wow. And men on the third position. The last competition that we participated in, Africa Cup of Nations with me, mm-hmm. I won the women, and I was second to Morocco in the men, and we qualified for the World Championship, which was in Germany. It was unfortunate that I didn't participate with them in that competition, because my contract was ending in June and the competition was in July. So Rwanda Rwanda, they don't have beaches. Here we have Indian Ocean, we have we are using artificial. We brought sun and we started and we became African champion. Most of the time they were writing stories about us. This is a country of 1,000 hills and they are the African champion in beach volleyball. I had a chance also this year before the Moroccan trip, before they were appointed me. I was working with Patrick Owino, with the beach volleyball girls, and I was trying to help them, and I was very happy that they came second in this competition, and I hope they will qualify for the Olympics next year.
I remember interviewing Waithaka Kioni, the current president of Kenya Volleyball Federation, some time back, and I inquired on why the male counterparts have not been performing very well, both at the continental and international stages, and probably his reason was that, you know, women and in particular Malkia Strikers do get, you know, good facilitation from even the continental body CAVB, and like men. I don't know whether that remains the reason for you.
I don't think so, because when I started working with Rwandan national team, I pushed the men side until we were beating Cameroon, who are ranked number 3. And it's only that we started with the youth and junior, with the same age group that we managed to be among. We were ranked fourth in Africa after beating Cameroon. Though Cameroon was ahead of us, I managed to beat Cameroon. And the Cameroon were participating in the World Championship. And you can imagine, I started in secondary school. So that means if we can have those youth and junior program, we can bring men up to the same level. When we were in Kasarani this year for Zone 5, Kenya played so well against Egypt. They took one set. There is one set they were leading 24-20 to get to the two sets. Today, as we are talking, Egypt have won 2 matches in the World Cup. The same group which Kenya was about to beat. So it's just a matter of giving them chance, giving them sponsorship, and they will reach there.
Policies, systems, in terms of structures at the Mashinani, because you run a very successful championship in Amaco Volleyball Tournament with good sponsors on board. How is it like at the local level in terms of talents, and especially in schools? Because I've covered Kenya sports secondary school games, and there is immense potential in Kwanzanza, in Malava.
For sure, school association, they are doing a great job. It is even federation, they are depending on them. And I have visited several areas since I came, and I'm telling you, there is great potential in Mashinani. And what I'm afraid is that this big schools that they are now the champion in East Africa or in our country, they are going to a certain area to bring in players. If they don't develop their own players, then you'll find that in future we'll only have the players coming from the same region. I remember one time when we were recruiting the players in 2006, the group of Washu, Wangeshi, we were going up to Tetu High School to select some players. But now, if you don't go to Rift Valley or Western, then there is no any other player that you can get from Central, Machakos or the other. And you find now those schools are shining, like Kwanzanza. 99%, all those girls are coming from the Western or Rift Valley.
So it's about scholarship.
It's about to nurture those students who are in that school, not to go to Rift Valley to poach or bring them to your school. I think we can develop anyone at any given time. This year, as a Kisii school won the school competition, but 85% of the same students, they come from my village. So so it is affecting those students who are coming from Kisii.
The locals
who could have
gotten an opportunity
to. And they have talent. It's only chance. They believe in what we have. But us, we just provide them with the net and the ball. They are always, all the time, they are playing. So when it comes to
school, I think, Fred Openda, with your financial muscles and considering that you come from those areas of Kisii, now that they are poaching other students from other schools to shine for them, it's high time you pioneer an initiative where you have to embrace your very own.
Actually, I remember when we were in high school, not even in volleyball only, even in football, you used to find that schools used to go to poach students from somewhere else so that they can come and train for their schools. But as Paul Pitok is saying, it's a disadvantage, actually, to the locals. And we should now come up with the measures to ensure that the locals also get the same chance to shine. And Bitoko was saying, he wanted to come back in for consultancy, really, where he can give advice and such. So in such a scenarios, which advice can you give for this school, to these schools, in order to maybe to help nurture the local talent, not to go outside there and poach other students?
You see now, we must have excellent centers in each region. Mm-hmm. I'll give you an example. When I was in Rwanda, I had three centers for men and three centers for boys. Mm-hmm. There is a primary school competitions which were going on. I could go there and have their names, have the data of all the students at that category. And then I convinced their parents mm-hmm. to take these children to certain school. Mm-hmm. And I could go around 1 week to train them in those schools. And this is where now coming in, why we should have a national coach which has a contract. Because you will have time to move around and to monitor and to help and advise those coaches what to do. Mm-hmm. Now here, our scenario now, the coach of the club is being appointed to come to the national team. And then down there is no one who is following what they are doing. So the player will come at when they are 17 or 20 years, they have their own style of jumping, mm-hmm. they have their style of putting their hands and the movement. Mm-hmm. It becomes very, very difficult when it comes to the eye level. Mm-hmm. So a federation must come up with their own structure on how to develop up to those schools. They must have coaches who have studied how to deal with the young players, not just leaving everything open, hoping that they will have one talent which is coming from nowhere mm-hmm. To join the national team. Oh. So it's really complicated.
How was the experience in Japan during FIVB World Cup?
It was very interesting, especially to other coaches. They were surprised to see Africans have really improved. They are playing modern volleyball. We could give them rough time. I remember when I went before, 2011 or 2006, they could not even call for timeout. They could not even substitute their players. But this time you could see the coaches were really stressed when they were playing with us. Mm-hmm. And they were even telling us that you have improved a lot. Your way of play is different. Before, you could find three players. They are running for one ball. We could be taken to hospital because maybe we could not
each
collision. Yeah, and I was very happy each time that when we have a press conference, they are really thanking us and congratulating us for what we are doing. They were telling us if we continue the same, then it is possible for them to lose to African countries. They were surprised also with Chepchumba, how she is so powerful. They were admiring her, wondering, are you seeing weightlifting or what? And Chepchumba, she has never even have this kind of program of strength training, and which we are introducing to her. And I'm very happy now, three or four players have been invited to go to play in Europe.
Oh, for professional volleyball?
Yeah, for professional volleyball.
How relevant is the position of technical director in volleyball?
Yeah, I think the position was introduced 3 or 2 years, but if you try to ask really the role of the technical director, it's not clear. So I think they should sit down and know what are the roles of the technical director. Is it for the Malkia Strikers alone? Is it for together with the men? Is it to work with schools? Is it to work with coaches only? Because there are different roles. We need to sit down and come up with certain position which are the right ones, not just the name.
Technical director.
Yeah.
I know there is a burning question Fred Openda would want to ask, but he's shy. But I'm going to ask on his behalf. I know, Coach, dealing with these ladies is sort of a challenge. How How manageable do you, you know, overcome the challenges associated with dealing with young ladies, vibrant, robust, pretty?
At the beginning, when you have no experience, maybe it can be challenging to you. But to us, we have been there for a very long time. We take them as a professional work. You have to respect your work. It's the same as the way you are here.
Yes.
You have to respect your colleagues. So this one helps a lot. And when you take your work as in a professional way, you will never go wrong. But if you mix the two, then at the end of the day, no one will have results. Because the moment you mix with those things, it will be a problem for you,
for
the team and all the players.
Okay. Now, which way forward? I was talking to Maxwell and I said, Bitok, there were rumors that Bitok is once out of coaching now. He wants to go into consultancy. But you've told us that there are negotiations between you and the federation and all that. But now, another question comes in. If you're not able to agree on the coaching aspect, what are your plans?
I was valued very well in Rwanda. They gave me a very good contract. They respected the contract. I worked on it, and I developed volleyball in Rwanda. Now I came back here thinking of in a different way what I should give to the Kenya Volleyball Federation. Now I have several things I have to do to earn a living. I'm not under any contract now. Malkia strikers, they are world level now. They are looking forward to be in the Tokyo Olympics. That means there's a lot of time which will be taken if I'm the coach to be with them. Mm-hmm. What am I going to be earning? Mm-hmm. If I am not with them, I can do some other business or do my own things. Mm-hmm. So it's a bit complicated to me. Mm-hmm. As much as I wish to help them, I also need to earn something out of it. Mm-hmm. And I'm saying this to help us also in future, so that we can have a neutral coach not coming from the club. We must have the contract for the coach. Not only me. The Malkia Strikers is a big team. They are playing world level. Why government cannot give a contract to the coach? Why should we have a contract for the coach from the Ministry of Sports to only football or maybe in rugby? If we are playing World Cup and World Championship at this moment, and they don't have a contract coach, that means if we can have an international event coach having contract with the Kenyan team, that means we can move to another level.
So all sports disciplines will be treated equally.
You imagine if I'm a coach for KCB and coach for Pipeline, and I have a chance to promote my player from Kenya Pipeline to be in the team so that they can help me to win some competition as a club. Mm. I'll give chance to that. Mm-hmm. So to have a neutral coach is very important.
Yeah,
and then there is also respect to their players, because they are not favoring any team. Even in training, sometimes it's very, very difficult. You push the player, they say, because I'm not coming from your club. Then you are pushing me. You're not pushing so and so. So it is the right time to have a neutral coach for the Kenyan team.
Always a pleasure speaking to you, Coach, this particular afternoon. It's been a fantastic show having Paul Bitok, the acting tactician for the National Women's Volleyball Team, Malkia Strikers, now in negotiations with the government through Ministry of Sports to see whether he will be given a full-time contract to take charge of the National Women's Team. And of course, he's been formerly at the Rwandese National Team, now back home to serve the community. It's been a big pleasure having you, and we shall be looking forward to hear from you soon on the way forward of this particular sport.
Thank you.
Fred Openda, I know it's been nice enjoying and getting seated closer to the coach.
Exactly. Now, it's been awesome having the coach. We have never met before. This is the first time, and I like the insights. You know, the view that he has for the volleyball fraternity inside here, and then what the thinking. I like it.
Definitely. Every Saturday, 1 to 3, we're talking Matter Sports. And let's continue with the conversation on our social media handles at Wasike Maxwell, at Oso Roberts, at Y254 channel, hashtag touchline Y254. Don't go away. Of course, the programming continues. Keep enjoying and, you know, have a sporting weekend. God bless you.